that has been drawn out based upon, there is a syllabus that we have drawn based upon what the inputs we got from various people. And so various topics are going to be discussed in this syllabus. Today we thought is appropriate to talk about the post-COVID scenarios or post-COVID cardiac problems that we are facing. So the format is going to be like this, that we will like to start. I would like Dr. Rajesh Pandey to give us and his experience or his comments on the cardiac problems that he has seen in the COVID patient that he's managed. Then we will talk, I will have a small presentation on what kind of COVID cardiac problems that we are seeing in COVID patients and what is maybe the basis of them. And finally, we'll end with a case presentation on a specific problem, which is going to be presented by Dr. Anmol from Narayan Rudale. And everyone's inputs are invited at all times. You can either interrupt, ask questions, or give in your inputs. And I'm sure at the end of this 1 hour, we are going to all be much the wiser about how to go ahead. So I think setting the perspective, Dr. Rajesh, may I ask you to take the lead in telling us about your perspective about treating COVID patients and the cardiac problem that you faced in managing these patients in particular, since that is the focus of today's talk.
Thank you, Dr. Bhalla, for and Echo for this excellent initiative, particularly without involvement of pharma. So the second wave was pretty bad and pretty devastating. And most of us, you know, we lost somebody either close to us in the family or acquaintances or in the friend circle or a batchmate. So this time it was really bad. I lost three of my batchmates. One was admitted in our hospital. So what we found this time was, you know, there was a significant cytokine storm. And in addition to the effect of this acute cytokine storm on the lungs, we have and endothelial cells, we have involvement of the heart also, which would manifest as cardiac failure. And many a times we would have to deal with arrhythmias. So atrial fibrillation being most common. Hypokalemia was not an unusual finding. So ventricular arrhythmias were also quite common. And one of the most baffling issue was the raised cardiac enzymes. We would find that troponins were high, NT-proBNP was very high, and patient is, you know, is in hypotension. So we are not sure whether it is ACS or not. And that is the time when we would consult Dr. Bhalla and his team. And most of the time, this was a non-coronary, you know, just viral myocarditis or the effect of the COVID virus, coronavirus on the heart. And there would not be any regional wall motion abnormality. Treatment would be conservative and no specific medication. I think, Dr. Bhalla, you know about how we handle all those cases. So I think sometimes we would find that the heart function has gone down, a frank heart failure, cardiomyopathy. So those were the kind of problems that we encountered, specifically the cardiac problems.
So I think that's perfectly a platform for me to you know, present a few slides on what could be the underlying pathophysiologic mechanisms and what are the various cardiac problems that we are seeing or we have seen all in our COVID patients. So if anyone would like to offer their comments, just wait for my presentation to be over and then we may please... You're welcome to start. So I hope my screen is visible.
Yes, it is visible.
Okay. So this presentation has been made by one of our bright young associate cardiologists, Dr. Bilal, who is unfortunately tied up somewhere. So credit goes to him for this presentation. So let's see what could be the various manifestations of COVID-19, cardiac manifestations of COVID-19 and the heart. So one of the main things mentioned by Dr. Pandey was the presence of raised troponins and raised cardiac enzymes implying myocardial injury. The other thing he mentioned was myocarditis manifesting mostly as a global decrease in coronary in cardiac function. Thirdly, the presenting feature or a marker of worsening or marking the end of life were very severe or serious arrhythmias. As cardiologists, we were often brought in to look at whether the patient had an acute coronary syndrome. Most times we found that during the real epidemic phase of the second phase and also many times in the first phase, the presenting feature of a patient would be an acute ST elevation MI. Many times patient would come to our emergency with ST elevation MI and we did the RT-PCR or the CBNAT and it turned out to be positive and the patient had no inclination prior to this. Of course, other manifestations include shock, whether cardiogenic or septic or distributive shock, mixed shock, some cases of stroke. We know that there are cases of sudden death in post-COVID patients also who suddenly die at home. And what our case presentation is going to be, and we also have experience of patients post-COVID presenting with significant venous thromboembolism or mild, moderate or major pulmonary. And Dr. Bilal is here. So if we look at how the pathological, what is the pathology of the SARS-CoV-2 to cause acute myocardial injury or produce these cardiac and vascular problems? So these are the hypothesis. One is that there is a direct mechanical myocardial injury caused by the SARS-CoV infection and its binding of its spike protein to the ACE2 receptor. So this ACE2 receptor actually converts angiotensin 2 to angiotensin 1 and prevents the injury, the fibrosis, the vascular inflammation, the vasospasm caused by angiotensin 2. So once this ACE2 is inhibited, angiotensin 1 is not available and angiotensin 2 is free to assert all its deleterious effects and express its actions in lungs and heart, which is where it's most widely expressed. So this could be a direct mechanism. Other proposed pathways include a cytokine storm, which Dr. Pandey is very familiar with and which we have seen seems to be one of the triggers in the second week of the infection, causing multi-organ failure, also impacting the cardiovascular system, which is triggered by an imbalanced response by type 1 and type 2 T helper cells and mediated through release of large number of cytokines such as IL-6 and other inflammatory, PAF and other inflammatory cytokines. Other mechanisms of myocardial injury could be sympathetic hyperactivity caused by the cytokine imbalance, anemia, hypoxemic myocardial cells secondarily becoming damaged due to type 2 respiratory failure. And all these lead to a rise in the cardiac enzymes or rise in the troponin and are caused by a supply rather than a demand mismatch and what we call now as a type 2 myocardial infarction. The other features can be myocarditis and quite rarely, although we have seen, is pericardial effusion or tamponade. So myocarditis can be diagnosed in some instances by doing a MRI scan or a PET scan, and we are able to see or diagnose this. But of course, utilization of this has been limited in COVID, and mostly the diagnosis has been clinical. So clinically also, we've diagnosed myocarditis when we see that the previously normal LV function a patient with a previously normal or presumed normal LV function presents with a global kind of LV dysfunction. And we presume or call this to be myocarditis. Now, this can be due to various mechanisms. It is rarely only due to direct myocardial infection of the myocardial cells, more often mediated through some stress cardiomyopathy or some cytokine mediated autoimmune response, autoimmune injury of the myocardial cells, or some other mechanism, maybe sympathetic overactivity causing a Takotsubo kind of stress cardiomyopathy, or some other mechanisms rather than a direct myocardial infection of the myocardial cells. The next are acute coronary syndromes, and these can be due to, in addition to what we have just said about myocarditis and stress cardiomyopathy, widespread microangiopathic or microvascular thrombosis has been hypothesized as a mechanism of certain cases mimicking the presentation of ST elevation MI and causing an infarction without having evidence of obstructive coronary artery disease. This has been seen a lot in Europe and in the US, and in early series, almost 30 to 35% of patients with STEMI were found to have non-obstructive CAD. But we found that if there is ST elevation MI, mostly we did find that there are obstructive coronary lesions which do benefit from primary angioplasty. Of course, non-ST elevation MI in most cases is myocardial injury mediated by microvascular microangiopathic thrombosis and cytokine storm. So this is a good cartoon denoting that how this viral infection leading to inflammation and the cytokine storm is now affecting all the areas of the cardiovascular system, leading to microvascular dysfunction by endothelial causing endothelial dysfunction, leading to plaque instability or rupture, and leading to MI, myocarditis, heart failure, and precipitating arrhythmia. So you can see that it is a mediated injury of various parts of the cardiovascular system that are causing this to happen. So this is the proposed diagnosis and workup and management, and these are the standard methods. Unfortunately, the management for most of the manifestations remains to be supportive. There is no specific drug which can be used. The drugs that are used in the standard management of these conditions as they manifest continue to be used for the management of COVID-19 mediated cardiac injuries. So arrhythmias can also occur, and the most common method of cardiac arrest in COVID-19 is actually asystolic arrest. Very few cases seem to have a shockable rhythm. The commonest arrhythmia, as Dr. Pandey pointed out, in the ICUs are atrial fibrillation. And these mechanisms, again, could be direct viral damage to the myocardial cells or conduction system, worsening of pre-existing myocardial conduction, myocardial conditions or conduction disturbances, electrolyte derangements, any combination of the above, adrenergic stress leading to electrical stability, and finally ACS with ongoing ischemia. So all these together or alone can cause various arrhythmias that are seen in COVID-19. So heart failure and cardiogenic shock is present in a significant number of patients with serious COVID-19. And it is associated with a much worse prognosis, almost 5 times more common in patients who did not survive the hospitalization. Similarly, to troponin, elevation of NT-proBNP or BNP is not diagnostic, but is associated with an unfavorable course among patients who present with respiratory failure. So raised troponin and raised cardiogenic natriuretic peptides have got a poor prognostic implication. So heart failure again could be new onset cardiomyopathy, as we have discussed, or progression of underlying cardiovascular disease. Shock mechanisms again similar, can be mixed shock also, distributive septic shock or cardiogenic or a mixed feature. Now venous thromboembolism and pulmonary embolism as well as stroke, this is again a not uncommon manifestation, and the problem with this is this may manifest after the patient is discharged from the hospital, and these are the patients who might suddenly die at home. So these patients, it is important to recognize the risk and again to see whether we can prevent this. Unfortunately, there is no clear-cut guidelines as to how to predict this, but Some of the guidelines suggest that a D-dimer level of more than 1,000 may be predictive of risk, and these are the patients who might benefit from anticoagulation thromboprophylaxis. So this is again a large number of tests which are well known to all of us. And this is the summary slide. Cardiovascular patients are at increased risk of the disease, and the mechanism of treatment should be according to the WHO and CDC guidelines, which include wider use of telemedicine tools as we are evolving to it. The heterogeneity of response indicates that it's unlikely to be a single disease phenotype, host as well as the virus interaction takes many, many forms and promotes more or less severe progression of the disease. The most common cardiac complications that I have discussed are arrhythmias, cardiac injuries, pulmonary myocarditis, and cardiac failure. And cardiac complications may often appear within the second or third week after initiation of the fever or at a later stage of the disease. So I think this is good enough for us to end this little theoretical lecture. If anyone would like to give us their inputs or like to make some comments or share their experiences, this is the
Dr. Balla. Dr. Balla. I'm
yes, Dr. Welcome, Baveja. Dr. Jingan. Welcome, Dr. Jingan. Very nice to see you, sir.
Hello, I'm Dr. Baveja this time.
Yes. Good evening. Yes, go ahead, please. हेलो
डॉक्टर भवेजा की आवाज नहीं आ रही है तब तक मैं पूछ लेता हूँ. थैंक यू डॉक्टर भल्ला फॉर ए
नाइस लेक्चर.
डॉक्टर भवेजा आप बोलिए बोलिए.
हाँ जी हाँ थैंक यू डॉक्टर प्रधान. डॉक्टर भल्ला एज वी ऑल ऑफ अस वी नो दैट द कार्डिक सिक्वली सेट्स इन आफ्टर द पेशेंट हैज रिकवर्ड. इन मोस्ट ऑफ द केसेस वी हैव सीन द पेशेंट कम्स बैक फ्रॉम द हॉस्पिटल, द पेशेंट इज डिस्चार्ज्ड, एवरीथिंग इज फाइन. And then after a couple of weeks, the patient starts getting all these things. So what is the protocol so that the people like us who are family physicians who are treating the COVID patients during the first 10 days when the patient is recovering or is responding to our treatment, maybe it is steroids, whatever it is. So can we have some protocol so as to gauge the impending cardiac sequelae ahead of time? What precautions or what guidance could be there or what should have been done so that this sequelae doesn't occur, so that this thromboembolism or inflammation, etc., doesn't take place, or this can be prevented? So what is the protocol in that case?
Right. Dr. Rajesh, Dr. Pandey, would you like to throw some light and what are your thoughts since you have been discharging patients also, and what do you think on follow-up? And also, I'd like you to please welcome Dr. Bilal. You can take off your mask, who is a young cardiologist with us and has also been actively participating in the ECHO programs. So Dr. Pandey, and then if Dr. Madan is here, who's again a good expert of ours, we'd like their inputs to address this question, that how to predict, how to prevent, and how to treat these patients post-recovery from COVID who come with cardiac problems.
Sure. I think all of us are know about it, this, and also reading about it, the problems that patients face post-discharge. And it's been called long COVID by the lay press, and it's also called post-COVID syndrome. Now, a lot of symptoms can persist in the patients who are admitted in ICU. They persist longer, and in patients who are elderly, have significant other comorbid conditions, they may persist longer. Now, that is what causes confusion. Now, technically, it's been divided into, acute post-COVID, which is 4 weeks from the onset of COVID when they are discharged, up to 12 weeks. So these are called acute post-COVID syndrome. Beyond 12 weeks, if the symptoms persist and there is no other etiology to suggest the reason for having those symptoms, it is called chronic post-COVID syndrome. So these are known entities now. So you will have patients presenting with problem, almost 30-40% will continue to have these problems. Regarding specifically cardiac problems, chest pain and palpitation are two of the most commonly presenting problems that they often complain about. But in addition, there are, dyspnea and cough, which are also there. There could be persistent oxygen requirement in the post-discharge period. So they often confuse whether some cardiac ailment is going on with the patient or, you just have to advise that please take rest. These are not uncommon. So this is, to tell you frankly, an evolving field. Nobody knows what to do. But patients who have been sick, whose CT score has been high, who are believed to have lung fibrosis, physicians are discharging them on steroids. Antifibrotic as of now have not proven to be effective. There are no recommendations from the societies, although people are using. And of course, because of the risk of what Dr. Bhalla mentioned, DVT and potential PE, they are advised to continue on anticoagulants. Most of the time, the oral anticoagulants. How long? That depends. There is no hard and fast guidelines, but you can often check their D-dimer levels. If you feel they continue to be high and they have some persistence of symptoms like breathlessness, chest pain, you can continue for 2 to 4 weeks. Dr. Bhalla?
Yeah.
Would you like to add?
So I think let's divide them. One of the sub-themes of this topic was how to differentiate the innocuous from the serious. Say again. So how to differentiate the not serious from the serious problems of these patients. One of the very common things we are seeing as cardiologists in follow-up are patients coming to us with either bradycardia, less than 50 beats per minute, or with sinus tachycardia, 110, 120 beats per minute. So this is one of the most common reasons why we are being asked to do consultations for these patients, either telemedicine or likewise. What we found is that bradycardia seems to be an innocent bystander, and slowly over a period of time it resolved. It is not carrying any adverse implication. We've not seen any patient progress to complete heart block or requiring any further support. Similarly, sinus tachycardia, if it is associated with normal heart function, if the lungs are not fibrotic or the patient not hypoxic, then the sinus tachycardia also over a period of time seems to improve and gradually go away. This period of time may be something between 6 weeks to 12 weeks. So these two are simpler problems. Now, third thing regarding the propensity for, say, DVT, pulmonary embolism, how do we look at D-dimers? How do we advise our patients anticoagulants? Again, no consensus, but one of the ways is that unless the D-dimer is increased more than 4 times the normal, it is probably not worthwhile to give any anticoagulant prophylaxis. And if the anticoagulant prophylaxis is to be given, it should be given for not more than a period of 2 to 4 weeks. So that's what I have been following. And repeatedly doing inflammatory markers, I think we all agree is useless, whether it is IL-6, ferritin. I think we'll agree only D-dimer will have an implication, and that too significantly raise D-dimer. So having said this, once the patient is discharged from COVID with a serious morbidity, these patients do not seem to be doing well, and they have seen many of them come back for admission to the ICU, either with another intercurrent infection, again severe pneumonia, and their outcome seems to be very, very poor.
I think Dr. Bhalla and Dr. Pandey, you have done a wonderful about the various parts. Problems which these patients are facing. I have these patients who are having a problem is that they are having a paroxysmal orthostatic palpitation, that's a POTS syndrome. And they are regularly, this is one of the symptoms which is troubling them. And sometime I think what type of, which medicine will be most appropriate for them, because, and it is really troubling them. That's where their life is being disturbed because of this tachycardia, which is because of a, whenever the postural orthostatic tachycardia, what you say, POTS syndrome or whatever name you must say. But this is a very commonly now finding, which is now seen in our all these patients.
Right. So I think that is well explained by prolonged illness, recumbency for long time, elderly patients, comorbidities. So these are the patients and who will be prone to this postural orthostatic syndrome. Maybe good nutrition, adequate hydration will do. And now we have a particular drug, which is an alpha stimulator as midodrine, which seems to be otherwise not having any other implications. Maybe in some cases you can try that. Start it at 2.5 milligram once or twice a day, and then you may increase it gradually. But that is something for your own clinical judgment. But I think adequate fluids and then educating the patient that to be a little patient may help in the POTS syndrome.
Thank you.
Dr. Bhalla, Dr. Poddar Desai.
Yes, doctor.
You said ST elevation MI also can be due to microvascular emboli without any major problem in coronary arteries. So how does angioplasty help here without, or is it the medical treatment right choice here?
Yeah. So initially, you know, we have also been through a year plus of COVID as cardiologists. So our understanding and learning has also evolved. Initially, we were all so panicked that we started thrombolyzing every patient and not taking them into the cath lab. But soon we realized that unless we simply treating troponin elevations and other biochemical markers is not appropriate to be aggressive, because there are many sources of myocardial injury in these patients. So we are talking of ST elevation MI. Many times we did find that these patients had obstructive coronary artery disease like a conventional normal MI. So Dr. Bilal has been doing large number of, rather he's one of our frontline people who performs primary angioplasty, and he has done a lot of primary angioplasty in COVID patients also. What is your experience?
Sir, is absolutely right. In the earlier period, we used to thrombolyze the ST elevation MI. So almost 50% of patients respond to the thrombolysis, rest do not recover. So we took them to the cath lab. Sometimes we found their coronaries are obstructive lesions. Some patients found normal coronaries. So that was a microvascular
endothelial. What percentage of patients would you say in COVID had normal coronaries with ST elevation MI? I think that is Dr. Poddar's question.
Yes. Yes.
That is less than 5%.
So high. It's quite low, Dr. Poddar, at least what we found. And if there's no obstructive lesion, we do not do any angioplasty or
stenting. Right. So, yeah. So one Dr. Sumita has asked in chat box, the treatment of post-COVID palpitation in young.
Yes.
Written in chat box. Yes.
Yes. So now, Dr. Poddar, you are now designated to give us all the chat box questions. Thank you.
Post-COVID had some autonomic disturbances, and majority of them had tachycardia. So these young people, we had some residents in our hospital, colleagues, who responded well to beta blockers. For a time being, beta blockers, long-acting beta blockers, like metoprolol or some other medicine, 25 mg night time, they responded well to this. And more of an anxiety rather than autonomic disturbance. So an anti-anxiolytic plus a beta blocker can help.
Is Dr. Madan here? Dr. Hemant Madan is here?
Yeah, very much here, sir. Very much.
Yeah,
here.
So Dr. Hemant is a senior cardiologist and one of my real pillars helping in running the cardiology echo program now. So Hemant, what are your inputs as regard this question, treatment of post-COVID palpitations in young?
Well, Balal has been my student in Fortis Shalimar Bagh. Good evening, Balal. See, the thing is, he's answered it to perfection, you know, beta blockers, except that I would put one caveat that wherever possible, we should try and get an LV echo done to see the LV ejection fraction, because once in a while you would be stumped by low ejection fraction causing an appropriate tachycardia rather than an inappropriate tachycardia as a part of autonomic dysfunction. So before you put them on beta blockers, I would prefer, and in Delhi and NCR, it's not difficult to get a screening echo done anywhere. So I would just preface the whole thing by another step, that get a look at the LV ejection fraction before you know you start giving beta blockers. Once in a while, as you know, the case we are going to present today, once in a while there may be another reason for tachycardia.
Yeah. So in patients who have got normal functions and no other reason, I am also liberally using ivabradine.
Ivabradine, same here.
So you can use ivabradine initiate it at a lower dose, and you can increase to a maximum dose of 7.5 milligram twice a day, and usefully combine it with beta blockers also, and achieve, because it's very distressing for young people to have palpitations and everyone has now got a pulse oximeter, so they are recording their pulses and everything. It's more than 110, 120. It's distressing, both for them as well as for us. So beta blocker combined with ivabradine, provided that the cause of palpitation, nothing else except post-COVID without any other respiratory, pulmonary issues or cardiac problem. So that needs to be done. All right. So anyone, there are no other discussion points. So now we have a very interesting case, which is going to be presented by Dr. Anmol.
Good evening. I have a question. So I have a patient with palpitation post-COVID, and he had VPCs. When I did Holter for him, it is around 19,000 VPCs. So I have started him on beta blockers. What else should I do? His echo is also normal.
So this is exactly what the cardiology echo program is, that for real people to really get some answers for their real clinical situation. So thank you very much for this question. This is a very important. Hemant, would you like to take this question ahead, please?
Absolutely. I think beta blockers are the drugs of choice for such kind of, ectopics. The ectopy burden is obviously very, very high, 19,000 high ectopy burden. So beta blockers in good doses. Also, be careful to see whether they are monomorphic VPCs or polymorphic VPCs. The significance of two is slightly different. If they're polymorphic VPCs, they indicate underlying diffuse myocarditis, and therefore, they are kind of more sinister. Monomorphic VPCs are more benign. Another suggestion which I would make is check the potassium very closely. Sometimes hypokalemia worsens VPC burden, and just increasing the potassium levels to somewhere around 5 would actually be therapeutic in many of these cases. Most of them would die away in 3 to 6 months' time.
You mean the VPC, not the patient, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Sir, I have done his pro BNP, that is around 800. Prop I is negative.
Yeah, so
only serum electrolytes are left. These are monomorphic VPCs.
So beta blocker is absolutely appropriate if provided the potassium is all right. And just continue with this management. 3 months, 12 weeks or so should be, they should settle down. Provided he did not have VPCs otherwise.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Great. So I think it's time to move ahead to the case presentation by Dr. Anmol. And then we can end the session with any more questions or observations at the end of that. All right?
Yeah. Very good evening, one and all. Yeah. Dr. Anmol Malan this side. I thank Dr. Hemant Malan and Dr. Bhalla for the opportunity that they've given me. So this case is regarding a 57-year-old male who, with no pre-existing comorbidities, who came to us in the emergency on the 1st of February at around 10 p.m. with acute onset shortness of breath.
Can you share your slides?
Sir, I'm not able to since Dr. Maheshwari will be able to. She's the primary user. That is the issue that I'm facing, sir. Dr. Anjali will be able to share it.
Share his slides?
Yes, sir. Should I give you the share screen access?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just give me a second.
Yes. So then I'll be able to share.
So and can, like you, only... can you position your phone so that you can see your handsome face right in the middle, Anmol?
Yeah. And so...
Sorry, sir. Yeah. Ma'am, have you shared the access? Hello.
Sir, you can see.
Hello.
Already and then share. Just do the share.
Dr. Anmol, share screen has been given to you. All you need to do is, can you see the green button at the below? You need to share your screen through that, please.
Okay.
Yeah. Can you share it now? First, you need to open your PPT.
Yes.
Yeah. So just share your screen and then you can automatically share the thing that you want to show.
Yes. Right? I hope it's visible now.
Yes, please.
So, yes. So this is a 57-year-old male who, with no pre-existing comorbidities, he presented to us in the emergency on the 1st February at around 10 p.m. with acute onset shortness of breath with an episode of syncope. And he gave us a history that he was admitted in our facility about a month back, that was on 28th December, with mild COVID pneumonitis. His CT score upon admission back in December was 9 out of 25, with the blood investigations done revealing normal D-dimer levels, but raised CRP levels. So he came to us in the emergency. We evaluated him, got an ECG done. Prior to that, his saturation on room air was 85%. He had tachycardia, no chest pain though, but yeah, he had tachycardia then. So we took an ECG, which showed right bundle branch block with sinus tachycardia. And then we pursued, then I did an echocardiogram upon him, which showed dilated RV with normal LV function and normal RV function. So then we had the suspicion towards acute pulmonary embolism. In the meantime, we send in a cardiac triage as well.
Anmol, your slides are not moving in along with your what you're saying. So
sir,
can you show the ECG that you were talking about?
Yeah. So this is the ECG that was there. Am I audible?
Could you please describe the ECG in a little bit more detail? What is the ECG that you...
So,
it's very important, no?
Yes. So this ECG done showed RBBB with tachycardia. And we had S waves in lead one. And upon which I did an echo for him, which showed normal LV function in which RA RV were dilated with normal RV systolic function. Rest, no other gross abnormality was seen apart from grade 1 diastolic dysfunction. Upon this, we actually sent
in a... So can you, at this stage, just sum up what you have examined and found so far?
Yes, sir. So basically, the patient came with shortness of breath in lieu of with tachypnea and tachycardia. And the
ECG his first code. Presentation was as syncope, I believe.
Yes, sir.
One episode. He fell down. That's very important.
Yes, sir. He fell down. He had a
and was very breathless.
He was very breathless, markedly tachypneic, and had an episode of syncope while he came to us. When he came to us, his GCS was 15/15, but at home he had an episode of syncope. And based on all these investigations, all the scenario, we got a cardiac triage.
No. Yes, sir. Yeah, yes. So.
Yes. And in the meantime, I did an echo on him. The finding I've already shared. So which showed elevated D-dimer and elevated troponin levels.
So what happened? Why do you think he became syncopal? Why did he fall unconscious? What happened?
So that is what we were contemplating. He was showing exact signs of, he had marked breathing difficulty, tachypnea, and syncope. So,
but why syncope? What happened? So what happened? Because syncope is a very serious sign in this clinical scenario and can herald that this patient might die suddenly, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Sir, primarily because of the, it could have happened because of the occlusion of the pulmonary vessels leading to left ventricular filling impairment.
Okay.
Which would have resulted in a sudden drop in
at this stage of your investigations, mm-hmm. with breathless patient post-COVID, ECG yes, showing sinus tachycardia with some incomplete right bundle branch block.
Yes, sir.
And your echo showing dilated RARV with some mild pulmonary hypertension. What is your diagnosis and what is your immediate action to be done? What is your diagnosis?
Yes. So based on this, to me, it looked more likely like an event of acute pulmonary thromboembolism. So in view of which, I immediately shifted the patient to the CT room.
Anmol, many yes, times the patient is so sick, or his creatinine is 5, or the patient is on a ventilator with a BP of 80/40.
Yes, sir.
Go back. You are unable to do a CT pulmonary angio. Then what will you do?
Sir, based on the clinical condition, if the patient is in shock and it's a and just because of the underlying event that has happened, the patient's condition has deteriorated. We would like to thrombolize the patient.
Okay. So, in this clinical scenario, if the patient is in shock, you are with a high suspicion of pulmonary embolism.
Yes, sir.
Any other investigations that you can do which do not involve imaging, which may help you to make the diagnosis? You're right, this patient can and should be thrombolized on clinical suspicion alone in this setting, especially in the patient that's in COVID. Any other useful investigations you think that can be done at the bedside, which may help you in your diagnosis? Yes?
Echocardiogram is the next best
thing. Transesophageal echo. What will that show, Dr. Sumita? What are you trying to look for in that?
Pulmonary embolism or microemboli.
Right. So transesophageal echo will show you only the main pulmonary arteries and the bifurcation, and you may be able to see thrombus sitting there, but much beyond the bifurcation, the left and right main pulmonary arteries, you may not be able to see. But it is a suggestion. You can consider doing a transesophageal echo if the patient not very hypoxic or not very tachypneic, not requiring something like a BiPAP support, because the patients during this procedure can become quite hypoxic. Okay, then anything else?
And depending on the clinical condition of the patient, we have to take a call whether prior to thrombolizing, whether the patient's hemoglobin level is all right.
Or I'm talking of diagnostic. So two things you can do. One is what you have already done, which is a D-dimer, which may help to point you in the direction of, yes, that this is an extensive thromboembolism. D-dimer, remember, is an excellent rule out. Just like NT-proBNP, if it is negative, then you're dealing with something else. If it is positive, it could be many things. But if it is negative, it's a rule out, just like NT-proBNP. If a patient is breathless and the NT-proBNP is normal, it is not heart failure. So similarly, D-dimer can be used, and you can do, as a bedside, you can do a venous lower limb Doppler quite easily. to rule out these might be bedside aids which can be done at the bedside and point you in the right direction, because thrombolysis by itself is not innocuous treatment, you know, isn't it? You'll agree thrombolysis carries its own weight of contraindications and side effects, so you may consider doing these investigations. All right, please carry on.
So yeah, so after informed consent, we upon
you did a CT pulmonary
we got a CT pulmonary angio done, which showed extensive thrombus in bilateral pulmonary arteries with dilatation of the right pulmonary artery. And there was thrombus in the distal half of the right pulmonary artery involving the bifurcation with extension into the upper lobe and descending pulmonary artery and into the lobar and segmental branches as well.
Show the image and point out where the thrombus is.
So this...
Where is the thrombus?
So this is across the right pulmonary artery. There's heavy thrombus burden.
So that darkish shadow, which yes. is seen, or is that the left side? I think that's the left side. That's the right side.
Right side.
That's the right side. That dark pulmonary shadow that's sitting in the right pulmonary artery. And on the left side also in the branches, you can see those dark shadows, which are there partly obscuring the lumen. So that's those are the actual thrombi that we see.
Anmol, can you just use your pointer and show?
Yeah.
Sir, I'm trying to figure out. So this, is it visible, sir?
No, we're not seeing it. Okay, doesn't matter. I think everyone can see on the left side of your screen, there's a dark filling sort of defect inside the bright right pulmonary artery.
Yeah, and also around 9 o'clock position, you can see.
Yes, 9 o'clock. Okay, next.
So upon seeing this, we took a call and after informed consent, thrombolyzed the patient with the injection tenecteplase.
How much?
So the patient's weight was 60 kgs. So we gave him 30 mg tenecteplase, sir. 35 mg.
Is tenecteplase an approved treatment for pulmonary thrombolysis of pulmonary embolism?
So we've given
the approved thrombolytic. The approved thrombolytic actually is alteplase, TPA. But yes, there is a lot of data people who have been thrombolized with tenecteplase also. So it's a fibrin-specific thrombolytic agent.
Yes.
Fine. And what are the advantages of using tenecteplase?
Also, in a lighter vein, I must clarify that, you know, thrombolytics are virtually unavailable in many hospitals with active cath labs now. So probably you get one odd dose, and because tenecteplase was available, we decided to go ahead and, you know, give rather than...
That's a good reason.
Yeah, because, you know, I mean, I'm sure it's the same in B.L. Kapoor that if you want thrombolytics, it's more difficult to procure than to do a PCI somewhere.
No, somehow we made a TP available, but yes, absolutely right. It wasn't easy to do that. All right, so carry on, please.
Gradually after thrombolysis, the patient's condition improved over the next 2 hours. The tachycardia started settling down. His saturation improved symptomatically. He was feeling better. And over the next day, by afternoon, we did a repeat echocardiogram, which showed normal ejection function as in the previous echo, and the normal RV systolic function and the RV size are also significantly reduced as it was dilated in the previous echo.
Right.
Then,
so how did you follow up this patient? How did you follow up this patient clinic, and what medication and what is your plan?
So we put him on oral anticoagulants while we sent him back.
Which one did you put him on? Warfarin, or did you put him on?
I'll probably answer that because Anmol may not be aware. He's been on follow-up. I've just completed, I think, 6 months of his Eliquis. He was on Novax. We repeated a CT at 1 month, which showed markedly reduced thrombus burden but had not disappeared by 1 month. So I've decided to give him Novavax for a period of at least 1 year, you know, so that because he presented with massive pulmonary embolism, even though it was COVID related, but it happened about 3 weeks after recovery from COVID. So I want to be very sure and want to give it for 12 months. Probably I'll do a CT pulmonary angio at around 12 months and then decide. Also, something which Anmol has probably not mentioned is that we did a Doppler for him and there was no peripheral venous thrombosis. You know, whether the entire thrombus had migrated or whether it was de novo pulmonary artery thrombosis, we don't know. But he had no incompetent veins. He had no dilated veins suggestive of a thrombus originating in the lower limbs.
So probably, so have you concluded? Then you can stop sharing, Anmol. We can back to the discussion.
Yes.
So thank you. So I think post-COVID, severe spontaneous life-threatening pulmonary embolism, and this patient presenting with syncope means that the thrombus or the thromboembolus came and sat at the pulmonary artery bifurcation. There was no cardiac output, and this is why this patient collapsed and became syncopal. And fortunately, this thrombus migrated or fragmented a little bit and went into the branch pulmonary arteries and allowed some perfusion. Or the next shower might have been fatal for this patient. So syncope in a patient of pulmonary embolism, very, very significant and a very ominous sign, I think we should take. So this is the case presentation. Now, case is open for discussion and any comments, any observations, any experiences would like to be shared. Can I invite my dear friend, Dr. Ravi Kalra from Pune, who is a head of cardiology at yes, Ravi, good thanks. Evening and welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Thanks. I'm Dr. Ravi Kalra. I'm head of the Department of Cardiology at Bharti Vidyapeeth in Pune. So,
Dr. Ravi Kalra is a very eminent cardiologist and retired recently as commandant of AFMC. And he has had a vast clinical experience, now heading Bharti Vidyapeeth. So please, Ravi, go ahead.
Yeah, I've been listening with great interest because we are also very major, probably the second largest COVID hospital in Pune. And, you know, about pulmonary embolism, we are a resource constrained hospital. We treat the people from a different strata of society. And I want to mention that almost all our patients received kinase and they have done very well. They have done very well. So please don't junk this old drug, which is good for resource-constrained situations. It works almost as well. Only thing is, you have to wait for about 5-6 hours for it to start working. And one advantage is if at 24 hours you find it is not, you can continue for 48 hours, 72 hours, but that's about all. And very nice case. It's typical of what we are facing almost day in and day out. Only one thing, one more thing I would like. I mean, doing a TE, a transesophageal in a patient with BP of 80 and, you know, who's struggling to breathe with a massive pulmonary embolism. Anyway, what you can see transthoracic because the pulmonary artery and RV are right in front. So it may not be really easy to do in such cases, but good, very nice case.
Ravi, what thank are the there. Other post COVID cardiac issues that you all are seeing and what that you all have been facing in Pune?
Something very similar to what all has been discussed. It started last year. My own cath lab technician had severe COVID, and he was in ICU for about 8 weeks. We could barely pull him out. Young chap, he's only 30. Very active, non-smoker. And he finally went out on discharge and came back after about 2 weeks with an acute MI. And we found that he's got lot of fibrotic lesions. LAD, RCA, the culprit was LAD. Anyway, he's fine now. But what I'm saying is that a lot of acute myocardial infarction, but that is one extreme. But probably the commonest problem is palpitations and tachycardia. It's extremely common, and 5 months, 6 months post-COVID, and then it settles down. And between, we see the entire spectrum of what you've discussed. That's what.
So it's good to know that, you know, we are sharing similar experiences across the country. You know, it's reassuring that, you know, all of us are going through the same thing. And I think a platform like this is very, very great for knowledge sharing, information sharing, and, you know, learning from each other. So are there any other comments or about this case in particular? Or would anyone else like to comment something about what their experiences? And then we have one or two questions, with then we can close the session if with the final comments.
So can I make a point or two about?
Please.
You know, the pulmonary embolism is actually a disease which should be treated when you suspect it. You know, that's a point. Don't be shy. Don't be afraid of thrombolizing patients, because the chances of death due to pulmonary embolism is real. Chances of complications due to thrombolysis are relatively remote. So, you know, if you have a clinical situation where you suspect pulmonary embolism, there are some ECG changes, there's hypoxia with hypotension, which is of relatively acute onset, go ahead and thrombolize. The bleeding rate with thrombolysis is less than 6%. Major bleeding rate is around 1%. You know, so it's much safer to thrombolize than not to thrombolize. I'm sure all the cardiologists in this group would agree with this.
And if you have
totally
a preference...
I agree with you, Hemant. I totally agree with you. And you must have a high index of suspicion. And mind you, pulmonary emboli, we have diagnosed clinically and only confirmed.
Yes, absolutely.
For paradoxes, look at the JVP, Kasmol. And that gives you enough ammunition to start your thrombolysis.
So I think great. The take-home message is, if you suspect pulmonary embolism, treat it.
Sir, one question. Good evening.
Yes. Hi, Dr. Seema. Welcome. I was looking, where is our Dr. Seema today?
Sir, actually, this patient had COVID. I believe CT score was 9 in December.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So at that time, was the patient given anticoagulation?
No, ma'am. The D-dimer levels were within normal limits.
Okay, that's what I was just coming to, because I have not gone by the guidelines during this COVID session, and I have given anticoagulation to my patients at least for 2 weeks, especially if their CT score was high, like more than 5 or so.
Dr. Seema, there are no guidelines, first of all.
Yeah, that's what, because I have not gone by D-dimer, sir.
Guidelines keep shifting all the while. So you go by your judgment, and, you know, even in our own hospital, I'm sure 10 different patients have 10 different on discharge advices. You know, there are some you start based on comorbidities, some you don't start. So we are all learning, as Dr. Bhalla said right in the beginning of the.
So last word with Dr. Rajesh Pandey before we conclude the session. What do you think, Rajesh, should be long-term prophylaxis? Do you think, you know, what you're seeing? So concluding remarks, and then we'll end the session.
Sir, again, there are no hard and fast guidelines. It has to be individualized for each patient that you are discharging. So if you have a patient who is, you know, still requiring oxygen, who is still bed bound, and if you have done a discharge CT, you find the CT severity score is 18, 20, 22, it's still high. And there are other factors, he's hypertensive, diabetic, or some other CKD, CLD. So these are the patients where you would like to go for post-discharge thromboprophylaxis, for sure. Other patients, I think you have to weigh the pros and cons, because giving for 2 weeks when you are discharging is not going to cause much harm, because these are pretty safe, NOACs are pretty safe drugs these days. So, and again, when you have to stop, maybe, you know, it can be guided by the D-dimer levels once post-discharge, and then you can safely stop it.
Yeah. So I think if I may sum up, what you're saying is that people who have had a serious COVID ailment should be on thromboprophylaxis as they are more prone to having these events.
Yes.
Patients with mild disease, maybe it's an individualized choice. If you feel giving NOACs for 2 weeks may not be harmful, but for mild cases, it's left up to the physician. Since there are no clear-cut guidelines, and we are unexpectedly surprised with massive pulmonary embolism, such as in this particular case. So I think that's a fair summing up. You'll agree?
One small point I would like to make. We, the Indian physicians, are giving more of everything. So we are erring on the higher side, and you know, be it steroids, be it, you know, anything and everything, we are doing it more than what is the Western opinion about those treatments and drug doses.
I think this comes from a long legacy of indiscriminately prescribing antibiotics, which we've been used to. We are free, you know, we're gunslingers from the West, so we are, you know, letting our patients have it also.
I call our physicians, you know, physician community. You know, they all have a 007 license, James Bond. You know, James Bond belonged to a section called 00, where they were allowed to kill in the line of duty. They could fire their weapon. So that's what we physicians do most of the time.
So, yeah, but maybe in this pandemic, you know, let's hope that it has benefited our patients rather than otherwise.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're just taking last two questions from the chat box. One is from Dr. Vinay Hans. Which beta blockers to be used apart from metoprolol? I don't think that there is any better or worse beta blocker. Any beta blocker that you find is useful in reducing the heart rate, which is all of them. So maybe try not to use a combined alpha and beta blocker. And in many cases where patients have got a lot of anxiety, I have been using non-specific beta blockers like Inderal also, which has got other effects also to add on to. So any beta blocker that you are comfortable with, you can use to bring down the heart rate. And like we said, you can freely combine it with ivabradine also. And Dr. Sumita wants to know, can pulmonary embolism lead to lung fibrosis as a sequel? No, pulmonary embolism does not lead to lung fibrosis as a sequel, but it can lead to an equally serious complication that is known as CTEPH, that is chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. And this is seen in about 25% of patients who come with large pulmonary emboli who do not clear their pulmonary emboli and then go on to develop chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, which is a very, very difficult disease to treat. So it also has long-term implications. So I think that much for this session. Thank you all very much for participating. I'd just like to end with a few words more that we are now planning to have these sessions once in every 2 weeks. We have laid out a course syllabus based upon inputs. If people would like other topics to be discussed, please send your topics in. We'll try to incorporate them in various cardiology echo sessions going ahead. So the next topic is going to be on heart failure. What are the recent advances in the treatment of heart failure? And we're going to also tell you or address what are the advanced therapies for refractory heart failure. We also have other cardiology topics, which I'll be posting after this session on the WhatsApp group. Please go through, and your suggestions are welcome because this is a platform for all of us. I have gained as much as I'm sure everyone who has joined in this platform has gained. And the more topics that would like to be discussed, we'll be happy to. And we'd like more of experts and more people to be added on. So if you find that this format of discussion is useful, please tell your friends and other associates, juniors, to join this platform so that more and more people can derive benefit from this. So thank you all. Anjali, would you like to conclude with anything? So
yes, I will be sharing the feedback link of the session in the chat box. And I request everyone to please give the feedback for the session.
Yes.
I request everyone to please kindly give your feedback for this session. And we will be doing this session fortnightly. And I request everyone to give their views and write the comments. And if anyone wants to cover any topic, then you all can write it in the group, in the WhatsApp group.